After Bruce Willis revealed his diagnosis of aphasia in 2022, many people might have been left wondering, just what is it? Who's at risk of getting it? And what might it mean for a patient's future? Keep watching to find out more. It's easy to see how a disorder like aphasia can be extremely frustrating to those who have it, as well as those around them. This is because people with aphasia understand what they mean within their own minds, but can't communicate it properly. If you've ever struggled to find the right word to finish a sentence, then you can glean what it feels like to have Broca's aphasia, the non-fluent variant of the disorder. And if you've ever rambled while wrestling to get your point across and had no one understand you, then you'll know what it means to have Wernicke's aphasia, which is the fluent kind.
And then these people tell me that I'm doing with, and soon they're gonna move. So then I lived in a new period.
Aphasia wasn't properly understood until recently, especially after the advent of CT and MRI medical imaging technology in the 1970s. After all, if a doctor can't properly communicate with a patient, it's hard to diagnose them. Patients with aphasia typically rely on family members and loved ones to communicate on their behalf. It was only due to post-mortem studies of patients in the 19th century that researchers began to have an idea of aphasia's causes. In 1861, French researcher Paul Broca first identified the connection between specific local brain damage and an inability to properly process language. As you can imagine, aphasia is a devastating diagnosis to receive. It's often made worse by the loss of the patient's ability to hold down a job, relationships strained to the breaking point due to communication problems, and the onset of subsequent diagnosis, such as clinical depression. Aphasia can result from any number of causes, but particularly strokes, as these cause blood to stop flowing throughout the brain. Indeed, approximately 25 to 40% of stroke survivors develop aphasia. Other causes include tumors, infections, neurological disorders such as Alzheimer's, and physical injury. No matter the cause, if language processing centers like Broca's area or Wernicke's area are affected, then aphasia of any type and severity may develop. It's important to remember that there isn't only one kind of aphasia, but many different types resulting from similar causes. It all depends on case-by-case anatomical details. Because of the influence of age-related neurological disorders on the prevalence of aphasia, aphasia is usually more common in older people. Besides that, there's no one group of people more susceptible to the development of aphasia than another. At present, aphasia is more common in the U.S. than Parkinson's disease, cerebral palsy, or muscular dystrophy. Nearly 2 million people suffer from aphasia, in fact, and every year about 180,000 more people receive the diagnosis.
It's when the problem persists, if it's interfering with our functioning, that's when you really need to seek help.
Again,
understanding aphasia requires an understanding of the brain's different centers, or loci, each of which process a different action. Even though the right hemisphere of the brain is responsible for the left side of the body, and vice versa, for language processing, the division of responsibility between halves isn't strictly separate. In right-handed people, about 90% of the language loop's functionality is located in the left hemisphere. In left-handed people, responsibility is more shared between hemispheres, with 70% of the language loop being localized in the left hemisphere. These are the kinds of discoveries that went hand-in-hand with research into aphasia, particularly thanks to French neuroscientist Paul Broca in 1861, and then German neuroscientist Carl Wernicke about a decade later. Broca discovered that damage to the left posterior frontal lobe of the brain led to difficulties with language output. Wernicke discovered that damage to the left posterior temporal lobe led to problems with language input. Together, these areas form the ends of the brain's language loop, which is connected by a bundle of nerves called the arcuate fasciculus. The worst-case diagnosis of aphasia involved the complete obliteration of this language loop and a total inability to speak at all. For a long time, aphasia remained an utter mystery and completely misdiagnosed. Nowadays, doctors use an array of testing methods and medical imaging technology to check for aphasia. This allows for a full and complete portrait of the human brain and any potential injuries without having to slice open someone's skull. If a patient exhibits potential symptoms of aphasia, doctors turn to aphasia assessments as a first line of defense. These formal, clinically designed tools check things like speech patterns, rhythm and intonation, naming of objects, repetition, language comprehension, reading and writing, and so on. The Mississippi Aphasia Screening Test, for instance, is a quick 5 to 15 minute oral exam. The Boston Diagnostic Aphasia Evaluation 3rd Edition, meanwhile, is a more thorough and involved assessment of a person's language functions. On the high-tech side of diagnoses, doctors have CT scans, MRIs, and PET scans. CT scans use X-rays to take detailed pictures of bone, muscle, tissue, and organs. MRIs produce detailed pictures using radio waves and magnets, while PET scans produce 3D images of metabolic flow using a radioactive drug ingested by patients. Sometimes aphasia is a temporary condition that plays out as the body heals from an injury. If symptoms persist for more than 2 or 3 months, though, especially after a stroke, a complete recovery is unlikely. However, speech-language therapy can help a person with aphasia learn about their condition and live a full life. Such therapy can be one-on-one or group-based and involve pictures, gestures, teaching communication techniques, the use of electronic devices, and more. Speech-generating apps are also available to aid in day-to-day conversation. Besides such direct therapy, it's critical for people with aphasia to feel connected to others through support groups and social clubs. Because support from loved ones is an essential part of the recovery process, much of the treatment for the disorder revolves around teaching them how to cope too. Simple advice like simplifying language or not correcting the speech of someone who has aphasia can go a long way to making home life as natural and happy as possible. Thanks to cutting-edge therapy techniques and a better understanding of the disorder, it appears that those with aphasia face a brighter future than ever before. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more Grunge videos about your favorite stuff are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.